So I think we can start. It's 11. And this is the last lecture of the series about ITER and fusion technology and physics. And as I promised yesterday, in the part two, we will go a bit outside the core tokamak area and look in additional systems which are around. So today's program, you see here, we look briefly at the cryostat and the thermoshield, which surrounds the basic machine. Then we will look into the DFT fuel cycle, another very important technology for fusion, plasma heating systems and plasma diagnostic briefly, and then also very briefly the cryosystem. I will then briefly tell you what is the status of ITER at the moment, where are we? And then we are going in the last part of this lecture series into technologies which we need for a demo reactor. That means what do we have to develop after ITER? And this is particularly a tritium breeding blanket and a helium-cooled diverter, a structural and functional materials for the in-vessel component. That means we need a bit different materials for the inner part of the machine than we have today. Improvements in the heating current drive system, in remote handling, and possibly in the magnets. This partially is getting more efficiency out. Partially it's needed to go to to full steady state from ITER, where we have something like 3,000 second long running plasmas in the long term. And then in the end, I want to tell you a little bit what could be an Apollo-like program, or what I call the ultra-fast track to fusion energy, if really politics decides we need fusion faster than presently foreseen. So let's start with a cryostat and thermal shield. So around the magnet system in the tokamak core, you have a cryostat. This is shown here. It looks small on these pictures, but the measures are 29 meter diameter and 29 meter high. It's a single steel wall structure. It's a big vacuum tank in principle, but with lots of feed-throughs for the ports to the machine, for services inside the cryostat to the magnets, and also water cooling and so on to remove the heat from the tokamak. So this encircles the tokamak, and around it, there is, as you see in the top picture, there is a concrete bioshield, which kind of reduces the neutron flux on the outside. The cryostat is consisting of four sections. The lower part is called the lower cylinder and the pedestal ring. This is this pedestal ring here. You see also these columns down here. All the machine is supported on this ring. So all the machine supports from the magnets, from the vacuum vessel, are mounted on this ring here. And then the gravity supports go down onto the concrete building. And then we have two rings and a lid. And the diameter is 29 meter. But the accuracy of roundness and fitting these rings together is in the order of 4 centimeters. So that's also a challenge to assemble it, and a challenge to produce this with the accuracy we need. The other challenges, when we look inside the cryostat, is pretty full, as you see. There are all these services going in. There's a thermal shield here around the magnets. And there are all the water pipes going in to cool off the 500 megawatt on the blanket. There are also feeders going into the magnet and so on, the connections to the ports. And if we want to repair something in the cryostat, after the machine is activated, we will have something like 100 microsievert per hour radiation field, so people can go in for a short term. Previously, for maintenance, we had ladders and platforms in, but soon we thought a little bit more about it, and everything in there is heavy, it's big. So even to remove a panel of the thermal shield to access to a coil connection, this panel is several hundred kilograms and has to be lifted by a tool. The other elements which we would have to repair if we reconnect coils or so are up to 2 tons. So we need certainly tools to handle things, and some things we would like to do semi-automatic, some things we will have people with the tools together inside. So that's why we mounted, for example, on the top a set of rails. You see here the lid from the bottom, and we can run machines on it with arms which can lift things, which can do things. So it's a kind of semi-remote handling tool again, even inside the cryostat. Similar, on the cryostat wall, we have put set of rail. In any way, we have structural elements which we have to weld to the wall to keep it stable, because we have only a single wall with 6 centimeter thickness, and this is a very large cylinder. And it has to withstand the atmospheric pressure, and it has also 2-bar overpressure from the inside if we have a helium leak. And then we mount these orange rails. A vertical rail is like on a building site. You see a lift coming down, and then this kind of cartridges which come down vertically on some areas can then run horizontally in three levels, and they can again access lift away panels on the thermal shield, as you see here, and then go inside, and we can repair coil connections. For example, all the polaritic field coils have four subcoils, and if one of them breaks, we can reconnect them so that we work with three, and so we have some redundancy inside the coils should something happen to them. Always on the bottom of the machine, this is a bottom. Here you see the size of a person here as well. There are some platforms here, but you see the size of the coils down here, and also the size of the feeders which come into the coils, and so on. And again, we need tools which can lift things, which can go up, unbolting. Even the bolts are very large, and all hands-on operation are very difficult alone from the force point of view, from the weight point of view, so we always need supporting tools, even if people are close by. And as I said, due to the radiation field, people will in total only be allowed several hours work inside. Around the magnets itself, there is a thermal shield, and around the vessel, there is another thermal shield. We have an inner thermal shield, which shields the 100 to 200 degree hot vacuum vessel, and the fusion plasma then inside the vacuum vessel from the 4K coils. And then we have the coils, and then outside we have another thermal shield towards the cryostat. Both thermal shields are cooled with 80K helium, and such keep the radiation load onto the coils to a minimum. They are self-sustaining thermal shields. Here is the vacuum vessel part. It is hooked to the vacuum vessel on a few places because of thermal contact. This is also minimized just for structural integrity. And then also the outside thermal shield is hooked on a few places, mounted onto the vacuum vessel, and otherwise self-sustaining. So these are very large structures. In order that the thermal shield works properly, this is cooled, as I said, with cooling pipes, but also all these panels are silver-coated to reduce the emittance. So that was a brief go through the outside of the machine, and now we go further out and we go to the fuel cycle. Now, in a fusion reactor, in general, we have two fuel cycles. One is called the inner fuel cycle and one is called the outer fuel cycle. The inner fuel cycle is connected to the plasma, so we have to fuel deuterium and tritium gas into the plasma somehow, and we have to exhaust the mixture of deuterium and tritium gas with helium ash and with other impurities, treat it, clean it, separate everything, and then go back. So we have an inner cycle which just feeds the plasma. But because we need tritium, which is burned up, and if you look at the fusion reactor, we have 56 kilograms of tritium required for a gigawatt year of fusion power, and so we have to produce tritium. And we are producing tritium with the neutrons which the fusion process produces, with lithium-6, for example, also with lithium-7, and it is a reaction which produces tritium and helium. And so we need the outer fuel cycle. So in the blanket, in the reactor at least, in ITER not, we have inside the blanket lithium. And due to these reactions, we produce tritium. This tritium has to be extracted. Mostly it's done by flowing helium through these blanket structures and flushing out the tritium gas into an outer fuel cycle. Again, it's separated from the helium gas, from other impurities, and then goes to the storage system, which then is connected to the inner fuel cycle. So that's the general process which we have. Now, in ITER, we didn't decide to go directly to a breeding blanket. First of all, the neutron flux is a bit low for that. And also, we have 25 kilograms of tritium available, mostly in Canada, because the Canadians have developed the so-called CANDU fission reactors. These are reactors which run on natural uranium without enrichment. And in order to be able to do that, they have not water cooling, but deuterium cooling. So all the cooling inside is deuterium. And because of neutron reactions with the deuterium, you produce as a byproduct tritium. They cannot do anything with this tritium, so they just store it in storage units, and they have in the meanwhile 25 kilograms of tritium. And when we look now in ITER on the flow diagram how this fuel cycle looks like, then you have the injection systems here, the gas injection system, the pellet injection system. I come to the details in a minute. We have injections through neutral beams. So the neutral beam heating is a particle heating. It has hydrogenic particles which are accelerated, then neutralized and go in as neutral particles. So they need the fueling system as well. And then we have the vacuum systems, service vacuum system. This is just to service secondary vacuums. The cryostat vacuum system, this is used to pump down the cryostat. Once the cryostat is down, the pumps are running just to see and to collect helium from small leaks. But rest, the coils are cold and act as a large cryopump and keep the vacuum in the cryostat. And then we have the important torus cryopumps. These are the ones which exhaust the spent fuel or not spent fuel, the helium and the impurities. Now, these areas which are in yellow here, these are kind of contaminated areas. And they go back to a roughing pumping system and then go to the tritium plant. And this is a tritium plant here. And we have first the tokamak exhaust processing system. And then we go into isotope separation. So we separate deuterium, tritium, hydrogen again. We go to storage and delivery, which goes back to the fueling. And then we have effluences from this system and from other systems. We have titrated water. And so we have another treatment system which reduces the effluents further. And all the effluents which goes out to the environment comes from this system in the end. Then we have an analytical system to measure the different tritium inventories. And we have also a vent titration system, which is looking at the building. If we have small tritium leaks into the building, this system cleans the HVAC air and from tritium and is able to take the tritium out of the air. So it's a very complex plant. I will come to the details later. Let's start with a fueling system. The fueling system first is a gas fueling system. It's introduced in six locations around the machine, three on the diverter level and three on the top level, or four on the top level and three in the diverter level. We have three diverter ports for pellet injection and in two locations on the inside and outside. I will show you in a minute. And we have a fusion power shutdown system, which the safety wants to have, for example, if we have a water leak outside the machine and the plasma runs on and produces power and we cannot exhaust the power, there is a problem after some time. So we have a system which would open a valve, put impurity gas in and stop the plasma. The pellet injection beside the gas injection is an injection of frozen hydrogen pellets or deuterium tritium pellets. And these pellets are continuously produced in a screw extruder. That means there is liquefied hydrogen coming in on the bottom and then is compressed down. And also the temperature is lowered so that here we produce ice. And the ice is pressed through a nozzle. And there comes a knife on the bottom which rotates around and cuts pieces of this ice. And then these are accelerated by a gas gun. It's like a machine gun, which shoots this kind of ice pellets into the plasma. Why do we do that? Because the gas doesn't penetrate very large into the plasma, and so we cannot achieve the density inside the plasma we need for the fusion process. So we have to shoot these frozen pellets into the plasma, which are then, of course, evaporated and ionized, and so we can fuel deep with this system. And this injection is done from so-called injection casks. There is a tube which goes towards the plasma. And then there is the gas gun here. There is this extruder here. There is, of course, a cryopump here, which keeps vacuum and the surplus gas pumped out, also from the gas injection gun, and so on. And these kind of casks are standard casks. We can inject impurities as well as deuterium and tritium with these casks. Impurities are also used to radiate in the power away and to do certain other things. These pellets, when they're injected, they can go around curves because they fly on a kind of gas cushion. Because they evaporate hydrogen gas, they fly like on an air cushion. And so we can also shoot them along curved tubes into the plasma. So one thing is from inside, that's for fueling. This is the best way of fueling because when you make an evaporation cloud, you make a pressure here, and the pressure tends to go to the outside. So this cloud will drive itself into the center of the plasma, while when you inject from the outside, this pressure will be throwing the gas back out. From the outside, we use another injection system to create what we call small elms. So if the coil system, which I described to you yesterday, would not stabilize this edge localized mode, there's another way to trigger them early so that their power bursts are less strong. And this is another backup system to stabilize elms. That's why we have another injection tube here as well for the pellet injection system. And here you see a picture in an existing machine where a pellet is flying in. This you see in the H alpha or visible light. This is H alpha light, the red one, and this is a pellet evaporating when it is flying into the plasma. Let me go to the pumping system. We have several vacuum systems around the machine. I just mentioned them before. So we have the torus vacuum, so we have to keep vacuum here. We have to exhaust the ashes from the plasma. We have around a much larger vacuum, which is the cryostat vacuum. And here you see the cubic meters down here. Then we have the neutral beam vacuum. These are the large injectors which inject 1 mega electron volt neutral beams into the plasma. And then we have some guard vacuums, service vacuums, and smaller vacuums for other heating systems. And how is this vacuum generated? What are our main pumps on the torus as well as the cryostat? These are cryopumps. You see here a cylindrical cryopump. Green is the 80K shield, and in blue you see the 4K panels. One is shown here. I will show you more details of it later. This is a connection to the torus. There is a valve which we can open and close here. So these pumps are pumping for 400 seconds, then the valve is closed, and the pump is regenerated at 80K back into the roughing system. And here you see the regeneration lines, filters, and goes back into the roughing system. This is elsewhere. And here is the cryogenic control box, which controls the different helium flows into the pump. The pump panels on the 4K are quilted panels. That means they have three tubes, so to say, which are just made by making some electron beam welds down here in the middle and then blowing them up. And there's helium flowing through them at 4K. Now, at 4K, you can pump deuterium and tritium, but you cannot pump hydrogen and helium. You cannot pump anyway by freezing. So what we have to do to be able to pump hydrogen and helium, we have to coat these panels with charcoal. Charcoal from coconut was the best one. And so this charcoal has a lot of little microchannels, and at this low temperature, these microchannels trap the helium and trap the hydrogen, and that's called sorption pumping. And there's a certain capacity, which once it is reached, once these trapped channels are relatively full, then the pumping speed goes down, and you cannot pump anymore, so you have to regenerate, but you have to do that anyway with a cryopump, because we also are not allowed to put an inventor in the cryopump, which then would be so large that there would be explosion possibilities if we have a high oxygen inbreak. We have only seen Fukushima recently, what happens if you have explosions, so we want to avoid that. So the amount of hydrogen in these pumps is always kept below explosion limits. Here you see these panels, these 4K panels coated with this charcoal. And here you see also again how a pump looks like. This is a valve. This is a half-size prototype pump. This is also the panels, the 4K panels of this half-size prototype pump. When you look now at steady-state operation, for example, in ITER we have 3,000-second pulses, then we have 8 pumps running, and what you see here is P means pumping, so every element here is 150 seconds, so we have pumping, then we have helium recovery, that means we try to recover the cold helium, warm up, exhaust, that means pumping out the regenerated hydrogen, and then cool down again, and then we go back to pumping, and we have staged the pump in a way so that we have a continuous pumping of the machine. And we have other cryopumps as well in a similar technology. These are cryopumps in the neutral beams. You have on two sides of the neutral beams, you have these huge arrays of pumps. You need a very strong pump in the neutral beams because what you do, you accelerate negative ions, and then these ions go through a gas cloud. In this gas cloud, they take from the gas the slow, they're stripped, they lose the electron when they go through, so they become neutrals. And this gas has to be pumped differentially along the way, and therefore we have very large cryopumps here. Again, 80K shield, and then three rows of 4K channels behind. And you see we have three neutral beam lines here. Two will be installed in the beginning. One will be as an upgrade. And we have a diagnostic neutral beam, which has lower energy. It's used for a different purpose. Each of these beams have, and I will show you a bit more later, 40 amp current. So 40 amp hydrogen current. So this is a very high current, 1 megavolt beam. And here you see a bit the cryogenic connection to all these cryopumps. There is a circulating pump with a pass near the machine. And then the cryopumps are served. There are different circuits. One is for helium recovery, which I just mentioned. And then when you warm up the pump, it goes back to the cryoplant with a warm, with a part of the warm helium. So we want to save cryogenic, let's say, power. But nevertheless, all these cryopumps have 15 kilowatt of 4K power. So it's quite a large part of the cryopump which is servicing these pumps. The roughing pump is also cryogenic. We looked at a lot of pumps, I can tell you. But it's very difficult with tritium because many of the mechanical pumps have seals which are working with oil, and they are not totally tight. They have differential pumping and rotating discs and so on, and in the end, oil area. And tritium and oil is not very good. It's very difficult to recover tritium out of the oil. And so it was difficult to find a pump. In the end, we found pumps which are mechanical but can work at high pressure. I will show you in a minute. And before we make a compression system, which is cryogenic again. So this is a roughing pump. So this is where the regenerated gas comes in, or when we rough down the machine. And then it's a condensation stage, cryogenic here. Then we have one area where we go separately out and pump the helium out because this doesn't condensate, but there's not so much of helium in the plasma. And then the rest is then regenerated from time to time of the condensed hydrogenic isotopes. And the pumps, the two pump types which we can use to pump this out are Normatec scroll pumps, which are, as scrolls, they are tritium compatible, they are used in tritium systems, and so-called Toyo piston pumps. But they all work only at higher pressure, so that's why we have to pre-compress the gas in this kind of cryogenic stage. Let me go then now a little bit more in detail to the system which then treats these gases, namely the tritium plant. So we have looked at this part, buffing, Mutter beams, cryopumps. So what happens here? Tokamak exhaust processing system. The gas comes back. It's a mixture of different hydrogen isotopes, of helium, and of chemical bounds of tritium, deuterium, hydrogen to, for example, carbon, hydrocarbons. All of these kind of things come out, helium. So the first stage in this thing is a palladium permeator. That means the gas comes in, and hydrogen, which is all the hydrogen isotopes, diffuse through the palladium into a separate area and go then to the isotope separation system. So you get rid of all the hydrogenic atoms. So they're atomized, and then they go through and so on. But we have a lot of chemical bounds left, and in order to get the tritium out of these chemical bounds, we have stages of palladium permeators with catalyzers which break up the chemical bounds, and then we have always inside the permeator, we have a hydrogen stream. The hydrogen permeates out and replaces the tritium in the chemical bounds which are cracked up. That means we are exchanging tritium with hydrogen in different stages, and we get a reduction of the tritium content in these chemical bounds by a factor 10 to 8. We have to get the tritium out because we cannot allow that to go into the environment. Isotope separation system, this works in a cryogenic column. There is a column which has a few centimeter diameter. It's 4 to 5 meters high. It's cryogenic. It has a temperature gradient from 4 degrees to 20 degrees. And then by the temperature gradient, you have the different hydrogen isotope. There's also a packing inside, a kind of structure inside which helps it. Anyway, you have tritium on one side, then you have deuterium, and then you have hydrogen on top. But of course, again, the separation is not perfect. So hydrogen on the top has a small amount of tritium with it, which is released, so we can again not release it into the environment. We have to go with it to the water titration system. So it goes back to the water titration system. Water titration system is another large column with catalytic packing inside. Another 4 meter column on the bottom is an electrolyzer, which cracks the water up into gas. And the counter stream again is hydrogen. Again, we make the same trick. We crack up the water into oxygen and hydrogenic elements, and we try to replace the tritium by hydrogen by this counter steam. So we make a continuous exchange, and by that we again can reduce the tritium in the water, and we can reduce the rest tritium in this gas which comes in here. And then from the water titration system, this goes into the environment. So there is a different cleaning stages. Similar from the vent titration system, this, when we have a tritium event in the building, we have huge volumes of gas. They go through an oxidation process, so we produce tritiated water, which is then a small percentage of tritium in the water, and we again go through the water titration system with it, and then can release it out into the environment. So that's how tritium cleanup works. And that's how the whole tritium and fuel cycle works, and how do some things look like. That's why I explained it a little bit before, because you don't see very much when you look at the things. That's, for example, is a tritium lab in Karlsruhe, which is the biggest closed fuel cycle before ITER will get in operation in the civil life. Of course, military also have some of these elements. And this is exactly the cleanup stage. This is a tokamak gas processing system in this glove box. So behind you see double contained cylinders. These catalytic processes run at high temperature. So you have several hundred degree temperature. And at that temperature, every stainless steel tube is transparent for tritium. So you have to have double containment, differential pumping, and again, a system which cleans out the tritium, which is diffusing through the steel into the secondary. And what you see here is a secondary containment. And inside is a real tritium system, and between there is a vacuum which is controlled and which is also detritiated with the same air detritiation system I mentioned before. It's oxidized, this water, tritiated water is produced. Then water detritiation system is similar like this. This is actually the cryogenic isotope separation system here, but looks similar. Only the water detritiation system has an electrolyzer on the bottom. And this is a cryogenic column. Again, the column is much smaller than what you see here because it's inside a cryostat here. It's working at low at helium temperature. And when you look at the ITER plant, then it becomes very impressive. This is a building of 80 meter links, 25 meter wide, and 35 meter high. And this is all the tritium systems here you see. This is like a large chemical plant. The big boxes belong to the air titration and vent titration systems because there's a large volume of air to be treated. And the smaller systems you see in this central part, this is actually the real titration system which I described you before. Let me go to plasma heating systems, another important peripheral system. In ITER we have 73 megawatt of heating systems, and we have three different heating systems. We already talked about the neutral beams. In principle, we have foreseen three beams on the machine. They are in a separate chamber. You see concrete chamber. It's a kind of a hot cell. You see these rails on the top. This is for remote handling operations in this hot cell, because we have large holes straight out of the machine into these injectors, holes with this diameter, and of course we have lots of neutron streaming out and activation also in this chamber here. This third injector is an upgrade, as I said before, so we have two injectors plus the diagnostic neutral beam. Each of these injectors will inject 16 megawatt of power into the plasma, but we have 1 megavolt with 40 arms. That means we have 40 megawatt going into this injector, and the rest of the energy has to be also cooled away. These heating systems are not 100% efficient. The other heating systems are wave heating systems. I described them briefly yesterday. The ICRH system, your ion cyclotron system, at approximately 60 to 100 megahertz. This is in resonance with the gyrating ions in there. And then the ECH system, this is shown here. These are waveguides for the microwave system. And these are at 170 gigahertz. These have resonance with the electrons which gyrate around the magnetic field. The power supplies for all these heating systems are back here for the wave heating system. The power supplies for the neutral beams are this way. There's a huge building, a megavolt power supply with this current of 40 amp each. The injector is a really impressive system, and a lot of problems with the megavolt and the high current. Here you see again a look into the neutral beam cell. These are the entrance for the megavolt connections. They come from a different building in high pressure, kind of sulfur gas protected to make to prevent arcs and things like that. This is a standard technology. But then the feed throughs into the vacuum, these ceramic feed throughs, and so this is a challenge, and into the vacuum to avoid having passion problems at low pressure and things like that. Then goes to the source. We have the source here, then this is the injector itself, neutralizer, ion dump, calorimeter, and then into the machine. We will soon see another picture of this, yes, a more accurate picture. So here we have a negative ion source. This is a plasma source which uses cesium ions to add electrons to the hydrogens ions, and then they are accelerated in an acceleration grid, which you see here. This is a megavolt acceleration grid. There are several grids to go up to 1 megavolt. Then we have 1 megavolt negative ions. They are going through this gas chamber. As I said before, there is a low-pressure gas in there, and they strip the electron from the negative ions, so we become neutrals. But we don't have 100% efficiency of that. So here we have an electrical field which turns the ions down onto a dump. So this is the ion, the residual ion dump. This takes the rest of the power, also more than 20 megawatt, go into a water-cooled structure here. And the rest of the neutrons, neutrals flow in here and go eventually into the machine. They are focused down. There are four beams, actually, four sub-beams produced here. They're all focused down, so to go to the small penetration into the machine. And if you want to know what exactly the neutral injected power is, we close this calorimeter here, and we dump the beam into a cooled copper structure, and then we can measure the energy which we inject into the plasma. That's how we get a good confirmation how much energy goes into the plasma. This is the ECH system. We have seen it from a different perspective. We have four waveguide bundles going to four top ports, and they can be also switched to one equatorial port. They have 20 megawatt of ECH power, which goes into the machine. The waveguides are approximately 5 centimeter diameter. The gyrotrons which produce this microwave are here in the building. Each gyrotron has at minimum a megawatt. The European produced gyrotrons have 2 megawatt each. And we have a beam, as I said, 5 centimeter diameter with up to 2 megawatt of microwaves. And the gyrotrons are looking like that. That's a European version. What you have is an electron gun, circular electron gun. So you make a cylindrical electron beam, which goes up here. Here you have a magnet around this area. In this magnet, the electrons start to gyrate and emit Bremsstrahlung, of course. And now you make, like in a laser, because gyrotrons are also called masers, you make a standing wave which is much higher frequencies than the gyro of the electrons in this magnetic field. So you make a standing wave in this cylinder, and we have here a coaxial tube. And the coaxial tube has the only effect to suppress some of the standing waves, which would be otherwise parasitics, which we don't want, and which would take power out. And so now this standing rotating wave, which is a cylindrical standing wave around this cylinder, picks up energy from the electrons like in a laser. It has a resonant energy pickup, and then this standing rotating wave goes up, and the rest of the electron beam also goes up here. And here you see that this channel is cut in a kind of way, because this rotating wave then is just at this point in such a way that it's reflected perpendicular out of this channel and not follows the electrons anymore. And here you see that again. So this is reflected on this mirror, and then goes out. This is a diamond window, and here the electron wave, the microwave goes out. The electrons go up here, and here we have an oscillating field, magnetic field, which puts the beams up and down to put it on a bigger surface to dump the rest of the beam. We have also a counter electric field which slows down the beam, which regains some of the energy back, so that these gyrotrons have quite a large efficiency. How big is such a gyrotron? This is approximately 2.5-3 meters high, has such a diameter. The tube here has such a diameter. So it's a relatively small unit, produces up to 2 megawatt of power, has 80 kilovolt voltage in it. So here you see different gyrotrons. Also other countries produce gyrotrons. Of course, this is ITER again. We don't have one type of gyrotrons. We have three from three different countries, and everyone has its own technology. The minimum requirement is they have to deliver a megawatt, and they have to do that for 3,000 seconds in the end, and not everyone has achieved 3,000 seconds yet. You see 800 seconds, 300 seconds, and so on. In the 2 megawatt in Europe are a bit behind, because it's much more challenging to produce 2 megawatts. But there is a large experience. This is done in Karlsruhe and Lausanne, so not too far away from here. These are the two main centers for the gyrotron development in Europe. And we have developed the gyrotrons for Wendelstein at 1 megawatt and steady state. So there is a lot of experience in this team. So we are very confident that this will be available at the time. So when we come to the machine, these microwaves are coming here in these waveguides. Due to the neutron streaming, we cannot have a straight hole through into the machine, so we have doglegs, which also have to be cooled because you lose power here. And then you go to a mirror array. This is a focusing mirror, and then you have mirrors which can change the angle a little bit because we want sometimes to inject it at different angles into the machine at different radius. We also, as a backup, and this is for a demo reactor, we will develop gyrotrons which can change frequency, where you can switch the frequency, which we call step-tunable gyrotrons. So we can switch the resonance of this rotating wave by switching the magnetic field into different fields. And this, we also have prototypes built, but for ITER they will come too late. Then we wouldn't need these mirrors anymore in the front. The last heating is ion cyclotron heating. This is a radio wave, kind of a radio wave kind of system, 100 megahertz, 60 megahertz. So it's nice UKW and all with a lot of power, of course. Again, we have 20 megawatt in total. Again, we have coaxial tubes, the diameter like that, coaxial tubes, in the meanwhile, standard technology, all of that. The issue here is this is the cheapest system back here, but the issue is how do you get the power into the plasma, because in the mineral beams and the ECH, they're like beams. They go into the plasma and they will heat. They have no coupling problem. These waves have a coupling problem. The plasma consists a kind of impedance, and the impedance is changing depending on the distance of the plasma in front of energy bursts coming out of the plasma. So normally, if you don't be careful and have a lot of compensation unit on the back, you have reflected waves going back to the generator and killing your generator. And so this is a real big problem. We are struggling since 20 years with this heating. It works to a certain extent, but it has always problem with the coupling, and we have gone through, I think, 10 different antenna designs, and they will get better and better in compensating this fluctuating impedance on the front. And so this is a system, if it works, is very nice for plasma heating. In present-day machine, it works to a certain extent, but this will be a system which in the end has to prove that it works in ITER, and otherwise it will disappear from the amount, from the possible heating systems we have. Let me come to diagnostic. We have 45 different diagnostic systems because we want to understand what goes on in the plasma very well. Some are for machine protection, some are for control of the plasma itself, and a lot are for evaluating the plasma performance and to understand the physics in the plasma and to see that we can improve the performance of the plasma. Improve the performance means get more energy out and improve the pressure in the plasma, improve the temperatures and so on. And that's kind of the diagnostic set around the machine, so you see that the machine is full of diagnostics. This is a kind of scene picture. What you see inside, this is also diagnostic. There are lots of cables inside in the machine and lots of small magnetic probes because we have to measure exactly the magnetic structure. This is a feedback mechanism which we need to control the machine. We have loops around which measure the loop voltage of the transformer and so on in order to understand how much voltage we have to make a certain current, to measure the current and all these kind of things. So there's lots of electromagnetic diagnostics, but then in these port plugs there are lots of other diagnostics. For example, there are spectroscopy to look at impurities. There are X-ray diagnostic neutron cameras, which looks at profiles of the neutron source by making tomography out of lots of collimators and so on. We have diverter diagnostics. So we have lots of diagnostic systems, and these are produced all over the world. And here we have a large experience base in the different laboratories. All of these diagnostics exist on existing machines. However, in ITER, because of the neutron streaming, because we cannot just go there, switch off the machine, go in there and repair something, these systems have to have a quite different state of reliability than they have today on the existing experiments, where hands-on is very much easier. And here you see such a port plug. It consists of different subunits. This is a neutron camera. The detectors are even outside. You have lots of collimators through, but it's not only the neutron camera. You have H-alpha diagnostic beside it, so different diagnostics. Mostly five diagnostics are together in one of these ports and look into the machine. And we need labyrinths. We have plasma interaction with the front mirrors where fast neutrons are flying out. They are eroding the surface of the mirrors. There is also impurities coming in as neutrons or ions partially, which are ionized due to radiation or other fast particles. And so we are coating the mirrors, and all these kind of things is a problem. The lifetime of the first front mirrors for optical diagnostics is a problem, and we have done a lot of experiments to see how long these mirrors will survive. The average lifetime of a port plug in the machine should be in the order of 5 years. So we are aiming at 5 years without repair. We'll see if we get to that, because this goes directly to the availability of the machine. Let me come quickly to the cryo system. The machine will be operated in 2 weeks time. It will have 11 operation days and a few days shutdowns. This will be three-shift operation, and then we will have 16 months of operation, and then we have 8 months shutdown plus a month on each side for commissioning again and so on. So this is kind of the operation scheme, and that's also the scheme how the cryo plant have to operate, because that has to deliver the cryogenic power. Here we see a large cryo plant in a building. We have the transmission lines, and then we have the distribution system and cold boxes around the machine. I will go a little bit more in detail. What do we have? We have 65 kilowatts of cryogenic power at 4.5K. Actually, we know we probably have to go to 85 kilowatts once we switch on real fusion power, because we have 20 kilowatt more heating than on the coils. So that's the first set with upgrade able to 85. We have 1300 kilowatt 80K plant. The helium inventory is for 24 tons in the helium plant, so it's quite a lot. We are already now in the conceptual design, and this goes out to industry as a conceptual design. The cryo plant will be produced partly by Europe. This is a liquid nitrogen plant. The helium plant is funded. That means ITER itself will procure it, and the distribution system is India. And in India, we have a few small problems. We have to check if they are able to do it, and this is ongoing at the moment. How these things look like? Because in ITER, we don't have a steady-state cryo load. We have huge pulses. When we have a plasma pulse, we get the pulse of heat into the system, and we have to damp that down. But we have 6,000 tons of cold structure, so that's used as a kind of buffer, and that's why we have here a bypass in the cold pump, which either goes through a liquid helium pass or can bypass the liquid helium pass. And this is a bit more details of the distribution system around the machine. So on two levels, on the bottom and the top of the machine, together with a water distribution system, we have the cryo system. We have all these feeders going in for the magnets, and they also transport cryogenic power to the magnets. Mainly there's magnets and cryo pumps, which are the main users of this cryo system. And that's a bit more detailed view on the cryo plant building itself. Here the compressor, the cold boxes. This is a liquid nitrogen plant, and these are all the gas tanks for the helium storage at room temperature. Now, let me go, after we went through some of these systems, where are we today? And just last year, we finally agreed with our governing body what kind of cost ITER can have and what the final schedule is. And so our cost, we have an own unit of account, which we call the ITER unit of account. These are dollars in 1989 values. This was done in order to make a value for ITER, and the cost of the different components is the responsibility of the parties who supply it. We cannot say how much a cost will be in China or in India or something. That's their part. We make a value of each part and say, this is a value, this is a credit you get. So this is a credit value of the machine. Part of it is used for 3,000 kilo IOAs. A kilo IOA is a $1 million in 89. 1,500 kilo IOAs is for us, for our own operation, for our staff, for our own procurement. 10% of the procurement is done directly by ITER. The rest is in kind. So in the order of 3,000 is in kind. So we have also some small contingency, which is not enough. Probably on the long term. And we have a contribution from the local area from France, because they had to upgrade roads, they had to build bridges, they had to prepare the site, which you see here, they had to flatten the site where the building comes, and so on. And also we look into the operation cost. This is 888 kilo IOA a year. That's 250 million euro approximately in today's money. Now, the official translation, if you just translate that by inflation, the official translation factor is 1.5, that it says 7 billion. In reality, it's factor 2. the real cost. So a machine will cost in the order of 14, 15 billion euro in the end. That's the team organization. We have a director general from Japan that was negotiated because Japan wanted also to build ITER in Japan, and so that was part of the negotiations. Also, some of these directors have been politically appointed. This is changing now. We are in the process of changing the top people at the moment and go to a more scientific appointment, which is good for the project. We have here the distribution of staff. EU has more than 60%. Normally, EU should have 50%, but some of the other parties don't deliver sufficient candidates. So you see China, and particularly India, is very low. EU provides 50% of the fund for ITER, and the rest of the parties have 9% each. And so that's how the procurement and the cost of ITER is distributed. This is a schedule. You see here the main big components. That's the TF coils, the central solenoid, the vacuum vessel, which is on the critical path, the buildings, and they all go into assembly, which then becomes the critical path, 4 years of assembly. And then we have here commissioning, and we have first plasma end of 2019. Now this first plasma is kind of a political nominal plasma. The machine is pretty naked at that time. Then we go into another assembly phase, which takes a bit more than one and a half years. And there, all the in-vessel components, everything will be planted. And then we can go into the first real operation phase with hydrogen. This is for commissioning the machine. So we have a hydrogen phase here. Then we have a short assembly phase three. There's the rest of the heating and diagnostic system comes in here. Then we have a second, more serious hydrogen phase, because here we have then the full heating power available of 73 megawatt. And here we will test some of the plasma conditions with a non-nuclear state. Then we have to go into a pre-nuclear shutdown. This is regulatory requirement, where the machine has to be made tight for tritium, tritium compatible, and so the tritium systems have to prove to work with hydrogen and so on. So the safety systems, safety authority will take a strong look on that. Then we start DD operation. That means deuterium, deuterium first. This is approximately a factor 100 in neutron flux less than DT. And then we go slowly to trace DT, so 1% tritium, 10% tritium, and so on. And then the first, full tritium operation will be in March 27 at the moment, which means the first attempt to go towards 500 megawatt will start in March 27. Now, we will not have the first shot, zack, and everything is working, but that's the plan. So around 27, 28, we should produce 500 megawatt of fusion power at the moment. This is a view of the ITER site. This is the PF production building. This is where the PF coils are produced. This is 250 meter long and 45 meter wide, 70 meter high. This is in construction at the moment. This is a cryogenic building, which we have looked at just recently. These are two power supply buildings. There's a large line coming in. ITER needs peak power of 600 megawatt and steady state 200 megawatt power. So we need a lot of power to operate this machine. That's where the tokamak itself is. This is the assembly hall. Yesterday we looked in a cut of this building. This is a hot cell. This is a tritium building here. In this annex here, you have all the tritium, which you have just seen before. On the other side, we have a diagnostic building. Then there are several auxiliary buildings. This is the office building, and that's the control room here with the machine. This is a bit the older status. We are a bit further advanced. This is the construction of the PF building. This is the excavation of where the tokamak will be. Half of the tokamak will be underground. Here you see also the construction site of the office building. I had some films, but I think time is short, so we skip that. You can look at that yourself when you get the files. So let's go now a little bit towards what happens after ITER, or in parallel to ITER, when we want to build a fusion power plant. Now, a fusion power plant in general is not so different from a normal power plant. You have a heat source, which is fusion, and you have hot helium coming out. Hot helium means 80 to 100 bar at 550 degree or higher. So very high helium gas, high pressure. That you can put through a heat exchanger to produce steam and then turbines, or you can have a heat exchanger and on the other side is a helium nitrogen mixture with 20% nitrogen. Why nitrogen? Because nitrogen have a stronger inertia and is better for turbines. It makes it easier. So if I have a percentage of nitrogen in the helium gas, I can have directly run helium turbines, which is more efficient than going through the water cycle. So that's how we go from producing power here in the plasma, which is practically 4/5 neutrons. So 4/5 of the power here is neutrons, 1/5 goes into the alpha particle, which remains inside the plasma because it's charged. The neutrons fly out, they go into the blanket, they heat the blanket, that's cooled by helium in a reactor, and that produces the 500 or 800 or 900 degree helium, depending which blanket type we use, and that's used to drive an electrical turbine. That's how we produce power. Now, what are the problems? This is kind of a sketch of a fusion reactor, bigger than ITER, again, as large as the large ITER, which I described yesterday, or a bit larger even. So, okay, first, breeding blanket. Yes, we have now water-cooled steel. This is not suitable for a fusion plant. The fusion plant, and I will show you the details, you need a blanket which contains lithium, which is, as I said, cooled by helium gas, for example, or there are also possibilities of liquid metal blankets. That means a mixture of lithium and lead, liquid lead. Then we can go to even higher temperature, but that has other problems in a magnetic field. Liquid metal has magnetohydrodynamic problems, and so it's really difficult to flow a liquid metal through a magnetic field. So the primitive or the easiest thing for a first machine will be a solid-state blanket. I will show you later the details. Then we need a diverter. It's also different. Today's water-cooled and copper. Copper is very bad for high neutron fluxes. It gets brittle and will not stand the necessary lifetime. So we are going to tungsten structures here, which run at 700 degree temperature. Again, helium cooled. And here you have to cool 10 megawatt at least away per square meter. This with helium cooling at 100 bar is a challenge. But we have made this big step towards this challenge. I will show you that. We need improvements in the remote handling system. We have to be faster than in ITER. That's clear. And we need other materials for these in-vessel components than we have today, because in a reactor, we want to leave these elements in for 5 years before we want to change them. And 5 years means 150 dpa. What is dpa? Is displacement per atom. So each atom will be displaced of his position 150 times. So you have, when a neutron comes, you have a kind of avalanche going through this material, you know, with thousands and thousands of atoms being displaced, a cascade. And this, most of these atoms go back to lattice places where they belong in principle, but some stay in between lattice places, and that starts to make changes to the material properties. This makes embrittlement. In addition, through the nuclear reactions, you produce hydrogen and helium inside the metal. These helium bubbles go to the grain boundaries, and they again make the material brittle. That's the problem. Also, you want to have a low activation material, and I come back later to that. Heating system, we also have to improve to steady state, it's clear. So let's look a little bit in some of the improvement. This is high-temperature superconducting magnets. And we have started in Karlsruhe a small program at the time. How can we do it? This is UPCO tapes. I don't know, maybe you have seen. These are nickel tapes on which evaporated is this UPCO with some protection layers below. It's one atom layer practically. It's a single crystal in a 2D plane. It has to be single crystal in order to be superconducting. And it's very brittle. It's ceramic on a nickel tape. Now, we need to twist the cable, but there's no cable. It's a tape. So we cut out the tape, you know, into a Roebel cable, and we do it. This is cables you know from accelerators. Then we have this this Roebel cable twisted around the cylinder like that, and we have produced a kiloampere or more in high field. We need something like 20 kiloampere, and so this cable already has 16, and we would like to have 50, in fact, similar to ITER. But we start to see a possibility to operate superconducting coils at 50K and not at 4K. And that's a big difference, because at 50K you have much higher thermal capacity. So thermal input here will be taken by the thermal capacity easily. So peaks of thermal input will not cause quenches. We have seen already in the current leads, which I showed yesterday, they are very resilient. You switch off the cooling and they go on, and then bang, yeah, sometimes they quench. So it really is quite a different operation regime here, and you're almost near liquid nitrogen temperature, so you're in a different regime, much easier thermal shields, and. So if we can develop that, that will be a big plus. Fuel cycle. Now, already in ITER is a challenge, but I can tell you in a reactor, we are orders of magnitude higher than in ITER. We have a tritium throughput, which is really frightening. And that's, you see here, in a demo reactor, you have, compared to ITER, the helium flow rates the tritium production, 500 grams per day, that's a lot. I mean, we have only 25 kilograms produced in many decades in Canada, so we have a 10-4 gap here and so on. So this is really a challenge, and this is the outer fuel cycle, which I called before, which is not really used in ITER except for test blanket modules. That will be a real challenge. Also, heating systems, as I said, we have to improve. We cannot go through the details. It's in steady state, maybe 4 megawatt instead of 2 megawatt, and so on for the gyrotrons, for the ECH heating, which actually is the most likely heating we will use in a reactor. This is the most reactor compatible heating. Now let's go to the breeding blankets. How does it look like? That's a simple solid breeder breeding blanket. That's the front line. There is the plasma. There come the 14 MeV neutrons. They go through a helium-cooled stainless steel wall. Behind, we have beryllium pebbles. These are 0.2 millimeter spheres. And here we have ceramic pebbles of lithium oxide. And this is the real breeder. The beryllium is a neutron multiplier to increase the number of neutrons which go through the breeding material. This is helium-cooled channels to cool these pebble beds and to keep them and to extract the power. So this extracting the power, this is the general how this looks like. And then in reality, these things are built in cassettes. So this is the breeding lithium ceramic. This is a beryllium. And the walls are all cooled with helium, all channels of helium flowing through all the walls, flowing through the walls between the separation as well, flowing through the first wall. And you see here how this looks like. You see here prototypes with these helium channels inside, also prototypes of the first wall, which are built and tested. Because in Karlsruhe, this is again done in Karlsruhe, which is a center of demo reactor development, we are building all these things. We are also designing in Karlsruhe the test blanket modules for ITER. That's again in ITER. So this kind of breeding blanket modules will be mounted in ports. There are 3 ports in ITER. From different parties, we will get test blanket modules. But behind, we have a large system. We have a helium cooling system, tritium extraction system. We have, of course, a control system. We have measurement station outside. So to operate this small box, which is this size, we need a huge system behind. And this is all testing the technology for demo. Also, right in ITER, also the helium cooling system is not straightforward and cannot be ordered from the industry. And also, the design of the machine will be different. You need the difference is that today the vacuum vessel is water cooled, also will be in a reactor. But if you go to 500 or 1000 degrees here, the blanket has to be connected to the vacuum vessel with a big compliance and also has to take the same electromagnetic forces, plus remote handling and so on. So all this has to be a little bit different. When we come to the diverter, we have to cool at least 10 megawatt per square meter here. So this is a diverter target. And what we found as a solution is helium shower heads. So high pressure helium with 100 bar comes here with 600 degree inlet temperature because the tungsten structure here needs high temperature not to be brittle. And then it's sprayed in many jets onto this tungsten surface here. And that can remove, due to turbulence, then the power which comes in here. This is a tungsten cap of half a centimeter thickness. This is a small finger head. Then there is a transition onto a stainless steel, special stainless steel, which can take high temperature and is also low activation, the so-called Eurofair dispersion strength and steel. And so that has been built. We had the collaboration with Russia here. And here you see the Russian facility, electron beam facility, a helium loop, small one, and here a picture of the test of these elements. These are small elements with 1.5 centimeter diameter, so you need many of these elements. But these elements have shown 1,000 cycles at 10 megawatt per square meter, which 5 years ago people said is impossible. But in fusion, you have to solve a lot of impossible problems. So now we go to bigger loops and to bigger tests also for ITER. So this is a loop built in Karlsruhe, a helium loop, which is able to go to 100 bar and 550 degree, and in a second step for the diverter will go to 700 degree and will be able to test large components like one-to-one size components for ITER or for one diverter target. Together with these in-vessel components, as I said, you need new materials which have 2 important facts. One is they don't get brittle under 150 dpa, and second, they are low activation. That means their activation decays within 100 years instead of thousands of years. And there you need to change in the steel some of the elements which normally is in the steel alloy. For example, you have to remove cobalt, you have to remove manganese, and you replace these things by tungsten, which is low activation, and by chromium. So you make chromium steels and tungsten. And these are the requirements. And the steel which has been developed is called Eurofair, and it has been very successful. It goes up to 600 degrees C with reasonable strength. If it is its dispersion strength version goes up 100 degrees higher for operation temperature, so it's in the right ballpark. And in order to qualify these steels, we need in the end a real good neutron source, because at the moment the steels are irradiated in reactors, but the energy of the neutrons is too low to produce a lot of helium and hydrogen like it will happen in fusion, and this embrittlement we don't know. So at the moment, in parallel to ITER, a machine is designed which will cost €1.5 billion. This is two accelerators with deuterium 40 MeV, deuterium accelerators, and they shoot on a liquid lithium target here, and this produces a spectrum similar to fusion spectrum. And the target looks like this here, so that's where the beams come in. This is a liquid lithium target, and behind you have half a liter volume of high flux and then lower flux modules behind. And the high flux module, the beam has such a cross section, so the neutron here is double the fluence of a fusion reactor, so we can test in 2.5 years the material. These are micro material samples which then will be tested. So that was a run through the technology also for demo. And now, just for fun, on the end, we look at what happens if someone asks us to do an Apollo-like program. So that's the normal program towards fusion. Normal is already fast track. So that's ITER, then demo will be designed and built. And then sometimes after 2050, probably at the moment I would say 60, 70 of this century, we may have the first commercial plant, maybe even later. Of course, nevertheless, we need what I said, the 14 MeV neutron source. IFMIF, which I just mentioned, we need to develop further the technologies for demo, and we need to develop through ITER also the physics further to develop some of the technologies which we already use in ITER further. So we have to put the basis for demo like we had to put previously the basis for ITER. And then we can start demo. Now, if someone comes to me today and says, oh, how fast can you build a fusion reactor and produce electricity? Then this is the answer. And the answer here is we could be mid-30s having the first electricity production. But we have to start now. And so let's look what we have to do. So the answer is yes, we can accelerate by 10 to 20 years at least if we start in parallel to ITER to build demo. Can we do that? Yes, because the layout of the machine, at least of a machine, if I put some margin in, will not change so much from ITER. Yes, we can then optimize it and so on. That's the next stage. But for a demonstration reactor where we develop the technology for demo, where we show how reliable the machine is, how much availability she had, so it's a demonstration, it's not a commercial plant, then we can build that in parallel to ITER and use the experience which the industry at the moment gets to build the different coils and so on, so that when the ITER coils are finished, 1 or 2 years later, you will have no experience more in industry. The people will go to other things. All the teaching of them is gone. But if you have a follow-up project, this experience will be there. So we need $25 billion to do that. That's the total cost in 16 years of construction and design, approximately. And I will go a little bit what this is needed for. This is $15 billion for the construction itself. There's a team. There's a few billion R&D. There's a few billion which we need for the IFMIF's accelerator source. We need to upgrade ITER so that it's a bit faster available with higher power, because we want to use ITER to produce the basic plasma regimes which we want to use. We don't want to lose time here in making plasma experiments, so we need ITER to run in front. And so this cost is my own estimate over the sum. It can be a bit less, can be a bit more, but that's something, but it's over 16 years, okay? We have other machines around the world. Maybe you don't know, JT60SA is another big machine which is built presently in Japan. It's half-size ITER, it's approximately the same size as JET, but superconducting, is aimed at steady-state operation. So this will produce the plasma basis, ITER and this machine, and ITER at DT operation, of course, at least 5 to more years DT operation before this demo would start, this ultra-fast-track demo. So we would have a good basis to start demo then up faster and lose less time to produce the right plasma regime. So what are the challenges? Of course, to get the money is a challenge. But the next challenge is, can we get the people? Because the people are limited. And we saw already in ITER that when we had to increase the staff, it took 3 years also in ITER. We'll take at least 3 years here to increase the number of people and to transfer the knowledge from some of the experienced people to this one. So people is a big problem, because that's a problem for every program which wants to expand very quickly. You cannot expand quicker than to teach the people and also to teach industry how to do things. We need 1,000 professionals in such a team. Technical challenges, I have shown you what are the challenges in front of us. But some of these things have been developed, at least basically. So we are not starting from scratch. We would have to improve the system. We would have to build bigger mock-ups like we did for ITER, and we will learn something. But the basic technology is already there. I have shown you before. So it's not something we don't know. What are the risks? Mainly economic, because when you build today such a machine, it's not clear what the availability will do. Of course, if you invest, for example, $3 billion in R&D, you will also use part of this money to look at reliability, to improve that. But nevertheless, considering the different, let's say, new technologies, helium cooling, long heating systems, and all these kind of things, that's the big question. What is the availability? How fast can we do remote maintenance? How often will we have to repair something? And there, we don't know. But like looking back in history, when the nuclear power started in the 50s and 60s, the availability was 40%. So it was not 90 like today. And I would start with 50% to 70% goal on a longer term. And also, we start to produce a very large machine which has some margin where we can change blankets later. I would see that after the first 5 years demonstration as a test bed for improvement, as a test bed to improve also efficiency of such a machine. So that the machine doesn't work at all is very low risk. We know that it will produce power. The question is how reliable. So I come to my end. And if we want to develop fusion energy, ITER is a key part of it, is the key part, actually, because we enter the reactor class. But in parallel, we have to develop the technologies for the blanket, the diverter, the material, all the technologies I mentioned. We need IFMIF to qualify the materials. And maybe we have to look a little bit at energy conversion, because at high temperatures, we can also produce hydrogen directly. From 800 degrees on, you start to have nice, efficient hydrogen production. So if one should say we want to use fuel cells for our cars, yes, there is a way that part of this energy can go into hydrogen production directly. So that's the finish of my presentation. Thank you very much.